All right, David Hoole, a futurist and author. And as we mentioned, you're here at the invitation of Jampro, I think, for the second year running?
For the second time.
Second time. And you're described as a futurist and a strategic thinker, advising largely businesses how to take advantage of opportunities that might not otherwise have been present without what you call it, foresighting.
That's correct.
All right. So how does that work, and how does that work on a country-to-country level?
Well, basically, people really don't think about the future, and businesses set up strategic plans that basically are based on the past, and governments don't really look that far ahead. They look far enough ahead to get elected, right? Governments aren't really forward-thinking. No government has a really 25-year plan or anything like that. So I travel the world. I do give a lot of speeches. That's how I make my living. And I advise companies and countries about the future. And that's why Diane brought me here last fall, and I'm back here again, because I think that there's so many huge mega dynamics going on in the world that will affect Jamaica. And Jamaica is such a wonderful place and has so much inherent brand possibilities that I'm here to try and help people think further out than just, oh, we're a place you can come and lie on the beach or next week's issue. I mean, I know you do a lot of business, but talking about the current news. But basically, foresight and thinking about the future is to take... What I say to corporations, like when I go into Fortune 500 companies, I say, forget your business plan. What is your vision? What's the vision of the company in 2023? Intentionally 7-8 years out, because they can't answer that with an honest question. 2-3 years out, and they'll give you a guess. But when I say, what's your vision 8 years out? Spend your time thinking about that, and then work back to the present. And that's what I do.
And when you do that, though, for instance, for a country like Jamaica, and you want to, I guess, predict the future, how much do you have to know about the island itself and what it's capable of, what its productive capacity is, what its characteristics are? How much of that do you have to know in order to, say, guide a government into certain areas?
I stay away from policy wherever I go. It's not my responsibility. My responsibility is to look at the dynamics, geopolitical, financial, that will affect Jamaica, and to try and get people to think about that as they set policy or as they allocate resources to attract investment.
But are the things that affect Jamaica likely or likely to affect other countries?
Yes.
Or, okay, so yes. You're looking at... what is likely to impact various countries, and you're here in Jamaica and say, well, this
yes,
could impact you.
That's exactly correct.
What are you looking at? What have you seen? What advice have you given to suggest what Jamaica should take advantage of right now?
Well, it is taking advantage, but it's also becoming aware of something things that will happen, and to think about them in advance so you're not in reaction to them. So just several things. Obviously, the Panama Canal is opening up. That's a significant thing. The establishment of diplomatic relationships between the United States and Cuba means that Cuba is going to have explosive growth, and the United States is going to focus on that because of the relationship and the history there. So if you think...
I'm a futurist then, because I've been preaching that we have to, business-wide and tourism-wide, have to react to that. We have to prepare for what is likely to happen.
Right.
The response I get from people in the know is that it's actually going to aid our tourism rather than hurt it. I don't get it.
I wouldn't agree with that either. First of all, it's Spanish speaking. This is English speaking. And you are at the center of the Caribbean. You're the largest English speaking country in the Caribbean. And how does that affect globalization? I mean, some people think you could become a transportation hub or a logistics hub. The other thing that I want to bring up, and I've just finished 2 years of researching a book on this, is climate change. Mm-hmm. And I am very optimistic about the future, and I speak a lot about it, the transformation of medicine, healthcare, education. But when it comes to climate change, I've decided as a futurist, it would be a dereliction of my professional duty to not talk about it. There's a great man you probably have read about or read of, Buckminster Fuller, who created the geodesic dome, right? He said in the 70s that humanity would approach a fork in the road, utopia or oblivion, in several decades. I think that time is now. And this book that I wrote, This Spaceship Earth, and the nonprofit I'm setting up around it, is just that fact. For example, it is now the conservative estimate that by 2050, there will be a 2 to 5 foot sea level rise. Now, it'll be varied around the world for a lot of reasons we don't need to go into, but even a 2 foot sea level rise means that there won't be beaches in Jamaica in 25 years. Okay.
Yeah. So actually, based on what we've been seeing, 5 years is probably more
likely. Yeah, well, there's a lot of erosion already on the South Coast. But if I might just come in here for a minute.
Sure.
I think why we invited David here was really to give us a perspective on some of the global trends, which I think Jamaica tends to live in a little bubble, in a sense. Some of us escape that bubble.
Our bubble includes North America.
It includes Only Miami. Includes.
Right,
Miami.
Right, right.
I do not agree it includes North America.
Right,
North America
right.
is a vast continent. Yeah. So people go that maybe to Miami, maybe to Toronto. But we really need to open our eyes to the global village that we're living in and to the impact of some of those global trends on our thinking. So we're thinking, in a lot of cases, too small. And we're thinking too much in that bubble. We need to start to look outside that bubble and to think about how Jamaica has impacted the world already in many, many ways. We punch above our weight. But how can we harness some of the ways in which we've impacted the world to make a greater impact on our livelihood? Because most of the people who have made that impact haven't made the money that makes them prosperous.
Here's the thing. I'm a lowly television presenter. We've just spent the last 2 weeks electing a whole new government, a whole new set of leaders. I'm assuming a whole set of people who are brighter than your average television presenter. Why is it they do not have that global, especially since they tend to travel a lot at our expense, why don't they have that global understanding that, you know, the world doesn't center around Jamaica and Miami and Toronto, that there are markets in India. There's a whole phrase called emerging markets, and it's about 15 years old. So why is it our business leaders and our political leaders aren't seeing it the way you see it, or indeed the way you see it?
Well, I would say that business people are in the business of making money in the near term. I've been called a CEO's futurist. I've spoken to advisors to close to 4,000 of them. And so I've tried to focus on what business leaders need to hear, which what's going to happen between 6 months and 5 years out. More globally, I go 10 years out. Business people don't think that far in advance. And politicians really don't think beyond the next election, to be candid about it, in the United States or anywhere. Mm-hmm. And when I wrote my first book, I started asking people, so what do you think about the future? In private, so they wouldn't be embarrassed. So what do you think about the future? And they tell me about their personal plans. Or they tell me how negative the future is. Or they say they don't think about it. So those are the three buckets. People either think the future is personal, it's their plans, or it's going to be awful, or they don't think about it. So what I try to say is, it's not personal, it's not bad, and if you don't think about it, it's going to happen unto you. So Dan's having me speak to a group of CEOs tomorrow at a very select gathering, and I think these CEOs are probably more forward-thinking than the people who work for them, but they're still not going to be thinking about the global dynamics that will be affecting Jamaica between now and 2030.
So you talk to them about, I'm assuming, current trends, very near future trends, and long-term trends. How do you determine, for instance, what's going to happen to marijuana in 15 years?
Well, I on my website, I am the only futurist that I know that puts up my forecasts and when I set them. So in September 2010.
And we're not talking crystal ball foolishness, I get visions and all that sort of thing. You're talking about examining trends.
Yeah, I mean, where I've been extremely accurate is in the price of oil and all things energy and a lot of social dynamics in the United States and around the world. So, for example, you mentioned marijuana. In September 2010, I said by the middle of this decade, meaning around now, that marijuana will be largely decriminalized in the United States of America, and it largely is, and it will be. You know, my forecast may be off by a year or two, or in terms of scale.
We won't sue you for that.
Okay, thank you. And so I had a conversation today when I was at the Jamaican Development Bank, right?
Yes. When
I was asked that question, because ganja is a marketable product soon into the United States. And so marijuana is going to be legal in the United States, it's going to be legal in Canada, it's going to be legal in Mexico by 2020. So how does that affect trade? I don't know, but I want people to think about that. I want to provoke people in this country to think about that.